Welcome to the Cambridge Tech Podcast, talking all things technology from the heart of the UK's tech capital. Here are your hosts, Faye Holland and James Parton.
Hi, I'm James.
And I'm Faye. So James, how's your week been?
I'm going to get through mine quickly because there's lots to talk about on your side of things. But we had a lovely trip out to Norwich, didn't we, this week, which you'll hear all about in a second. So, you know, it was really impressive to see the clustering and the collaboration going on down there. And the team at the Centrum are really friendly and welcoming. So we had a great time there. And then the rest of the I just attended the party of the year. So do you want to kind of explain what happened?
I love it's the party of the year. I mean, it's the end of the year, so I've done quite well with that. Yeah, we hosted a little bit of a party on Thursday evening. And so basically it was a celebration of 10 years of Cofinitiv, but I did kind of tease it with there might be a couple of surprises. So yeah, we just made a rather small announcement on the evening.
For the people that weren't there.
Yes, well, so we have been, my company Cofinitiv, which has been going for 10 years, and we have been acquired by a company called Cambridge Management Consulting.
Amazing. Congratulations.
Thank you. I mean, it is supremely exciting. It's kind of a bringing together of two minds who kind of think the same way. And we get to expand our portfolio and scale, which is something that a lot of companies will struggle with, and we did too. But we just have such great impact. It's a wonderful opportunity to just be able to be even bigger and do even more. So we're thrilled.
I bet you didn't sleep afterwards because the love in the room was off the charts, wasn't it? Everyone's was so complimentary about the kind of the contribution you make to Cambridge, and you must be so proud.
Yeah, no, I am. So when David Cleveley spoke, Christine Martin spoke, we had the Lord Lieutenant for Cambridgeshire, Mrs. Julie Spence, there giving the toast. And that was lovely. But then, like you say, I was run ragged the entire event. So yeah, definitely no sleep was had on Thursday evening. And then I passed out basically for the rest of the weekend. Yeah.
Like I say, brilliant news, and looking forward to the next chapter.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much. And people can go and look on social if you want to get some more info, or if you've got any questions, then do come and ask me. But basically, we just carry on as we have been doing, but just bigger and better. But that wasn't all. I did other things last week as well. I mean, that morning of the event, I actually had an AGM with the Chambers of Commerce. So that was quite full on. And I also met with another company who's looking at building their profile in Cambridge as well. So, I mean, it just continues to be such a buoyant place to be.
Yeah. Well, on that note, shall we transition into this week's tech news?
Let's do it.
Okay. Let's start with Trinity Braffield Prize and 21 to Watch winner Molyon, who announced they've raised $4.6 million to create a new future for sustainable batteries and targeting an $85 billion plus global opportunity. It's the first spin out from the Founders of University programme to raise external funding, and it's been co-led by IQ Capital and Plural. The money will kickstart manufacturing at a pilot facility in Cambridge through expansion of the core team, including battery engineers, material scientists and operations staff. So congrats to Dr. Ismail Sami and the other three co-founders.
Yeah, it's great news. And you know what I think is really interesting about that is that they're looking at building a pilot manufacturing facility in and around Cambridge. So very, very similar to what CMR Surgical did a couple of years ago. And it's great.
Yeah, and I'm about too. So yeah, that's really good.
Yeah. So Echion Technologies are back in the news again this week as they keep making headlines. They've now secured a further $10 million investment from Barclays Sustainable Impact Capital and existing investor BGF.
Yeah, and I guess to complete our trilogy of climate tech news this week, we have two Cambridge companies working in partnership. We have Carbon 13, who we recently covered, and they've just launched Carbon 13 SEIS 7, which is their seventh fund for pre-seed companies and the first to be managed by Cambridge-based Syndicate Room. So Carbon 13 typically has around 30 companies in their program. The seed investment scheme is a government initiative designed to help startups raise investment by offering generous tax reliefs. SEIS investors may claim a suite of tax reliefs, including 50% income tax relief on up to £200,000 invested and 50% exemption from capital gains invested into the scheme that arise in the same year. So nice to see a collaboration there.
Absolutely. And I guess head over to Carbon 13 if you're interested and you'd like to find out more. So, as we mentioned at the top of the episode, we headed over to the east, to Norwich Research Park, for this week's episode to cover the Innovation Hothouse competition. Like you say, James, what a great day. I absolutely loved it. There's lots of energy, lots of vibrancy there, and really interesting and different areas of research and businesses to catch up with. So, let's delve straight into this week's episode. We're thrilled to have Roz Bird and Sheng Qi with us today. Would you both like to introduce yourself? Sheng, you go first.
Yeah, so my name is Sheng Qi and I'm a professor of pharmaceutical materials and technology. I work at the School of Chemistry, Pharmacy, Pharmacology. We have a new name now at the University of East Anglia. And I also carry the role of being the Associate Dean of Innovation for the Faculty of Science. We have four faculties at the university. Faculty of Science is one of the biggest.
Perfect. Thank you, Sheng. Roz?
I'm Roz Bird. I'm Chief Exec of Anglia Innovation Partnership. It's the campus management company reporting to the board that includes the four research institutes, the university and the hospital here at Norwich Research Park.
Perfect. So we've all jumped in the car to come to Norwich today for the Innovation Hothouse. Very exciting event. Could you walk us through the history of the competition, how it came about and what you're kind of expecting from today?
Well, I can start by saying that one of the things I realised when I first got here in May 22 was a really low level of awareness with everybody about what Norwich Research Park has to offer, what we're doing, the mission, the science, the whole thing. And so I sort of thought, why don't we organise a thing called an Enterprise Showcase event? So they're coined now Enterprise Tuesdays, and we started them in February 23, and this one will be our sixth one. And my friend Soraya Jones, who was she's the first CEO of Cambridge Wireless, I've been talking to her since coming to Norwich Research Park and said to her, it's, you know, really great place. She was already involved at the UEA with innovation, and I said, come along to Enterprise Tuesday, and I'm going to put loads of cool stuff on the platform. And she is quite blown away, really. And at the time, she was applying for a role through the Royal Society as entrepreneur in residence. So she said, if I get that role and if I get to work with UEA, I would love to work with you, Roz, and do something like you've done with Enterprise Tuesday. And I said, why don't you do a UEA takeover sometime? So they did one last November. And then this November today is the second one of those. So it's a UEA takeover of the Norwich Research Park Enterprise Tuesday event, which is always just for a whole afternoon after lunch, where we showcase loads of cool stuff that's going on. And I think Sheng can probably take over from here about how the Hothouse competition and all of that format came about.
I think, yeah, this thing won't happen without me knowing Soraya and Ross, as it's piggybacked on the Enterprise Tuesday, which is such, I remember the first one I speak at it, and I was like, this is the best thing, you know, this is exactly what we need on the park. And it's exactly the thing we need for the university as well. And I was very fortunate to be able to convince Soraya to be our Royal Society Entrepreneur in Residence. And Soraya proposed saying we should do this. And I think it's the best vehicle, because what we are really short of at UEA is the showcase of letting staff know they can be recognized for their innovation, as well as to set role models for people who looking up to thinking about doing more innovation and impact-driven research and projects. So I think this is really the perfect vehicle for that. And Soraya initiated with the support of Roz. You know, we won't be able to do any of this. So credits to both Soraya and Roz for this thing happening. Last year, we had mainly UEA team, but this year is opened up to the whole NRP park with all the partners and the institutes. So we're really glad to see a much bigger variety of projects and organizations joining the competition, which is great.
So let's come on to this year in a moment. What I actually like to do is look back at some of the companies from last year as well. So we did cover it on the podcast, so regular listeners will have heard about them. But how have those companies from last year fared? Are there any success stories coming out of those finalists and winners?
Yeah, so we had our winner, which is the TraitSeq, which they already secured investment, which is brilliant. And we had all of the top three shortlisted for the 21 to watch last year. Virilitas and Ediform both were shortlisted, and we actually both went to the KPMG's Global Tech Innovator Award for the regional competition pitch. And I think Virilitas got two awards at the Cambridge Tech Week, which is really, really great, boosting confidence for them as well. And we had other groups like Chemistry Shed. They now are growing on top of the MRCIAA fund they got from the UEA account. And I think they are really looking into very soon to spin out. And similar to Opau, you know, we're working with other partners, industrial partners, and looking into the process of spin out as well. So yeah, there's a lot of a really exciting development for the last year.
Also that when I've talked to like seed investors and said, oh, what sort of things do you think we should be doing to support our entrepreneurs? They've said things like this, Roz, you know, pitching events, helping our entrepreneurs to practice their pitch in front of different audiences is so important. It makes all the difference. So I think that having the hothouse competition and then that raising the profile, encouraging them to then go on and it gives them confidence to go on to something else and pitch in another way. And some of them are pitching competitions and some of them are to achieve funding. But I think that it's really helped all of them. Some of them became virtual tenants as a result. They've definitely been attending our enterprise network events as well, meeting successful entrepreneurs and looking at how they can grow their business and pitfalls and things that they need to know in advance and prepare for. And the other thing I'd like to say is what I think hopefully listeners will get excited about is the attitude of our entrepreneurs, which I notice is quite different to some other places because they're anxious to do well and because they work so hard with their pitches and with their businesses because they don't assume that they're going to get anywhere with anything. They really know that they've got to prove themselves, not just the science, but also the fact that they can handle the pressure of a pitch and they have got what it takes. And one of the messages I'm going to give later in Enterprise Tuesday is about this, to say that I think we must retain our pioneering and piloting energy and motivation and that spirit within all of us to really continue to sustain everything we're doing at Norwich Research Park. And I think if we can keep our entrepreneurs on their toes and excited and anxious, they will win all the competitions. So it was really exciting to go to Cambridge Tech Week and see Virilitas and Celexel clean up. There were three prizes and they won all three. And I think it's because one guy had literally practiced all Sunday on his pitch.
Yeah.
Yeah, because they want it. And I think it's that spirit that is needed in a place. And that kind of attitude needs to be recognised. And that is why your listeners should be excited about the stuff we're going to produce, because that's the attitude.
Yeah, I mean, it's spirit, and it's also they're doing something that is actually very different by nature of what you're doing at UEA, what you're doing over here on Norwich Research Park. And Sheng, you just mentioned TraitSeq. We caught up with Joshua Colmer and Felicity Knowles during the event to ask them what had happened since they won. So Joshua, could you just level set everyone and tell them what you do at TraitSeq, please?
Yeah. So at TraitSeq, we build tools and identify biomarkers, which are biological markers that help agricultural companies predict the performance of products that they develop, whether these are gene edits, biologicals, crop protection solutions. And so the aim is that by enabling them with biomarkers and with tools, they can more effectively select the products that are going to perform best in the field.
And Felicity, it's been 12 months since you won the first Innovation Hothouse. So what's been happening in the last 12 months?
Well, it's been a really exciting 12 months for TraitSeq. So following the win from the Innovation Hothouse last year, we had an amazing time in terms of we hadn't even spun out of the Earlham Institute at that point, which we've now officially spun out, which was very exciting. And from that, we then have raised our first pre-seed funding round with a mix of investors, which has been really exciting. And from that, we've been able to really grow our team and our technical capabilities as well. So it's been a really exciting year, and we're looking forward to going on from there as well.
And how are you getting on with funding and investment?
So I think with funding and investment, we're doing rather well in that I think the exposure that we got from the Innovation Hothouse competition last year led to even members of the audience investing in TraitSeq, and then also bringing in Sapphire Capital, who are linked with Norwich Research Park, as well as a couple of other VCs. In addition to the funding we've got from investment, there's been a number of Innovate UK grants that we've been awarded. And then also, as our product is more a service that we offer, we've been able to generate some quite substantial early revenue from working with crop protection, gene editing, crop breeding companies. So in terms of runway, we're doing rather well, and it's quite a healthy position for TraitSeq to be in.
Yeah, you're very lucky having early revenue. That's something investors are definitely going to be happy with. So well done on that. And my last question is, you know, you won the competition last year. You're obviously progressing really well. What would you say to people who are thinking about entering the competition?
Yeah, I would highly recommend people to enter the competition. I think that the mentoring and the support that comes in developing a pitch deck and trying to understand the messaging and the communication of here is your company in 5 minutes is a very difficult thing to do, but it's very rewarding because ultimately you need to raise funds in order to grow your company unless you're lucky enough to build it organically, which very few will. So the training and the mentoring, as well as the exposure on the day, makes it a really worthwhile and rewarding process.
I mean, it's so great to hear about all the positive experiences and impact of last year's finalists and winners, which just goes to helping to build the credibility of the competition, helps with your marketing. And I guess these companies can then become mentors back to future teams applying and going through that process as well. So that leads me on to exploring this year's contestants. You know, what do the finalists look like this year?
Yeah, so as I said, this year is really, you know, big variety. We have pretty much every single partner on the park has teams entries, and they are really excellent. Some of them are at more advanced stage as well, which is great. And what I noticed particularly from the UEA side is we be able to now actually convince some very matured academic staff jumping out of their traditional academic route and thinking what I have been doing in terms of science is brilliant and that can be an innovation and an enterprise. So that is kind of them have that courage to break that mold and think differently, which is quite different. The last year, I think majority of entries are led by early career researchers, which is what we really want to do. We want to grow more early career researchers, you know, to be entrepreneurs. But I think the great thing to see this year is our colleagues, which are very well established academics, are having mindset shift, and they do recognize this actually is a great way to generate impact from their research. So I think that is the difference I see for this year's entries on the shortlist, which I'm really very excited about, because all I want to do, you know, with the rest of my colleagues and the support of Roz and Soraya, is to change the culture on the campus of UEA so we can get people excited about doing innovation enterprise instead of thinking that maybe another task for me to do, you know, on my to-do list. That's not what we want to do. We want the people to actually thinking that is an excellent pathway for promote and progress their career.
And we had 35 entries to the Hothouse competition in the summer, and Soraya and Sheng had to choose 8 that are pitching today. So that was a great number of entries. They were really pleased with that. And it just shows the kind of burgeoning interest that we've got in all of this. And then the 8 that are going to pitch today, have they had support over the last few months?
they have...
as part of the sort of package.
That's right. So it's become our autumn season on campus, become the training, entrepreneur training season because of the Hull House, which is great. A great benefit for us. You know, now we actually have a structured training season, you know, going the whole way from the finance to the IP, to the auditing, to getting legal advice. So the entrepreneur...
the pitch for today.
The pitch, I think the pitch is more individualized, you know, with Soraya one-to-one. So I think that is something we didn't have in the past, at least on campus, you know. Here, organized by AIP, there's a whole lot of more structured trainings. But within
that was Soraya's idea, to be fair. It's her input and her hard work, isn't it, to get all of that. And I think that's the reason I mentioned that as well is because listeners will think, oh, well, you know, they've managed to get 8 poor unsuspecting startups to stand on a platform today at Norwich. Well done. But actually, no, there was 35 That's applicants right. in the summer, and they were just the ones that were ready then. That's and right. we've now got 8 that have had proper input. And I think Mills and Reeve have been involved with that Correct. As well. Yeah. So what we'll see today on a platform will be very good standard, especially if it's like last year. And I haven't been involved with entrepreneurs all my career. I've only really done that over the last couple of years. But when I've gone to random pitching events where there are others from other institutions involved, I would say that the standard is higher at Norwich Research Park, which is great. And it was a surprise to me because, like I say, I hadn't really done this a lot before. But it comes back to what I was saying earlier about people being anxious to do really well. So I think it will be a good standard. And we've got 8 judges coming. Hopefully they'll be impressed. And it's not necessarily at this minute about, right, so are we going to fund your enterprise? But it is about your pitch, your credibility and your future prospects, isn't it?
That's right. Yeah.
So we also managed to speak to 2 of the finalists. So we're going to first talk to Rosario Campilongo from PF Bio. Hi, Rosario. It's lovely to meet you in person. We've been exchanging emails for the last few weeks, so it's great to be here in person. You are CEO of PF Bio, so why don't you tell us a little bit more about the company and what you're trying to do?
Thank you very much for this opportunity. Yeah, I'm the CEO of PF Bio. PF Bio is a spin-out company from the John Innes Centre. It's based here in Norwich Research Park. At PF Bio, we transform agriculture by creating innovative microbial solutions to protect crops and promote plant health as alternative to conventional chemicals.
And so we talked about with Roz and Sheng earlier on about the support that they've offered. What have you done as a early stage business to actually put yourself in the position of being able to now come out at the Innovation Hothouse and share your story a little bit more?
Yeah, well, the business started about 2.5 years ago. And I'm a scientist as a background, so I want to learn as much as I could to advance the business idea and grow the business. So I use all the support that was available. Anglia Innovation Partnership offer pre-seeds money, so I apply for grants to obtain it. And I've been awarded these grants, and that has been very useful for us so that we could start working in the lab and generate first results and then leverage from them. Then I obtained some support from Anglia Capital Group, that is the local angel group here in Norfolk and Suffolk. Yep. They organize an investment readiness program called the HELO program, and I was on it last year. That has been extremely useful because I've been mentored by 2 angel investors, so I understood how to prepare a pitch and all the information and the material I have to have in order to be ready to get investments. And I had the support of other mentors as well around Norwich Research Park. I had some mentors that followed me in the last 3 months before the Hothouse competition, Soraya, which has been absolutely great. And I've done some other program, organized the Barclay, the Eagle Lab, also has been very useful, especially immediately after pandemic, well, everything was virtual and so on. So I managed to be on an investment readiness program organized by them as well, where I probably was too early stage, but at least I learned how to write Innovate UK grants, as they give me a mentor specifically on that. So yeah, I always try to pull all the support that is available. It is free or relatively less costly than other programs, and has been great so far. I mean, just connecting with other people, experts, that is the most valuable thing as well. Connections, networking, And so far it's been great.
So you've got yourself into a good positioning. You've now got the platform. You've got you developing this proprietary platform. What's next? What are you looking to do next to progress the company?
Well, once we develop the platforms, we managed to identify microbial strains that we can use to generate our products and generate intellectual properties. So we aim to create products for farmers to support sustainable agriculture. And we also aim to license some of the IP that we are generating. So the next step will be to work on both these fronts, put out there in the market our first biostimulant product for the berry sectors, where we are very focused on, and generate new IP for bioprotectants for different other crops. So we are advancing multiple projects at the moment.
Brilliant. Exciting times for you. Thank you for coming in and telling us more.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
And we spoke to Sophia Jamal from Vida Vodka. So hi, Sophia. Thanks for taking the time.
Thank you very much for interviewing me.
So really fascinated by what you're doing at Vida Vodka. Why don't you just quickly explain what it's all about?
Okay, so in simple terms, what we're doing is we're taking waste bread and turning it into vodka. But more importantly, we're turning it into alcohol, which has multiple uses. Our goal is to try and reduce food waste and carbon emissions kind of at the same time.
So it's interesting that it's bread. So how much waste bread is there in the UK?
There's a lot.
Really?
Can you guess how much waste bread there is every single day? Give it me in slices. Give it in slices.
I've got absolutely no
in the UK, just in the UK. Approximate.
100,000. Am I nowhere near?
A little bit higher.
2 million. Faye's going 2 million.
Okay, are you ready? It's 22 million slices.
22
every
million.
Single day. So that equates to about 900,000 tons a year, which is about 2 million tons of carbon emissions.
Wow. I was nearly right then. 2 million was in there.
2 million, yeah, you're closer, a lot closer.
Is this because we're not allowed to feed ducks bread anymore? Because that's where all the waste bread
used to go. They went, you know what, we're chucking it now.
So it sounds like there's enough this here is, for you to scale as...
Very much
You're not going to outstrip the supply of waste bread.
Yeah, and you know, a question we always get is, okay, cool, you know, that might be coming from the households, but does that mean we can capture it? So we started to go to bakeries and we found out that bakeries operate at a 10% surplus just to meet their quotas, which means they have an enormous amount of waste. And when we started to pitch to different bakeries, they were more than happy to give us the waste. So we already have three. Each one can give us over 200 kilograms a week. And that's only in Norwich in a small little artisanal bakeries.
Yeah.
So we haven't even approached the big boys like Warburton's yet.
That's really interesting. So completely unaware of that issue. So the process, the science behind that, is that novel to you guys? Is that your kind of IP, your secret sauce?
Yeah, so we kind of started to do research into it. And the real IP for us is making it extremely efficient and cost effective. And that's kind of where it comes. Breaking down that bread into something that can be used and fermented is where our IP is.
Exciting. So the drinks industry is well established. It's dominated by big brands. How do you break into that? How do you find customers? And, you know, have you been encouraged by this recent trend of artisanal drink brands? And a lot of those have ultimately been acquired by some of those more established players.
That's exactly it. We're kind of positioning ourselves as a premium artisanal brand. And like you were saying earlier, to break into with customers, it is quite a hard thing to do, but we have a USP of being sustainable. We're carbon net negative. And the most important thing is we're seeing a huge trend in the drinks industry of people making those more conscious choices. A lot of cocktail bars have these new like net zero menus, which is one of the reasons where we're really getting popularity with a lot of the cocktail bars when we approach them. And people want to drink with purpose now, more so. A lot of the drink industry as a whole in terms of sustainability tends to be in the bottles. So you'll see a lot of bottles now, they're doing metal bottles. Absolute did like a cardboard bottle, but no one's really innovating at the actual liquid side of things. And no one really takes into consideration how much waste goes into actually also making a regular standard bottle of vodka, as apart from the food waste we're producing. But apart from that, you know, like you said, we do want to get acquired by a bigger brand. Diageo has a VC arm called Distill Ventures, and they really focus on brands that are founder-led, and they look for brands that are sustainable, diverse, and we kind of fit the quota for that. So we're kind of looking for an acquisition like that. We know that they've invested £300 million in 35 founder-led companies. So really, we see ourselves as a small artisanal premium vodka now. And as we grow, to get that global reach, we hope to be acquired by one of the bigger players who can kind of, you know, help us with that distribution, because I think that is one of the hardest things in this industry.
Mm. So how has the competition been for you? You know, what have you learned? And this sounds like a great stepping stone to getting that visibility of what you're doing.
Yeah, it's been amazing. I think first of all, the exposure has been great, but also just the one-to-one mentoring we've had with Dr. Soraya Jones. She has given us so much help. Through the process, we joined Barclays Eagle Labs and other programs, and this was like the first thing to give us that real confidence to kind of take it to the next step from an idea and ideation to like really pitching to a lot of people, especially when it comes to getting ready to pitch in front of VCs and to, you know, those bigger brands. This is like taking the training wheels off and kind of getting that first exposure and really getting used to it. We've pitched before, but nothing so formal or grander, you could say. So yeah, it's been great. And, you know, all of us, all four founders of us, we've really enjoyed this whole process. It's just been exciting. It's something to put all of our time and energy into.
Oh, that's fantastic. And good luck today.
Thank you very much.
So Roz, you earlier on mentioned the judging for this year's competition. So it's the two of you. You've got Simon Blakely, Ziki Lim, Dr. Jerry Wu, Emmy Nichol, and Dr. Jason Mellard on that judging panel.
Yes.
And Sheng, you are principal judge, actually. So what are you looking for? You know, what are you going to be judging from this year's finalists?
So I think we are same as last year. I think we're really judging based on the quality of the innovation and backed by solid science and knowledge foundations. And I think we are looking at the investability, the viability of the business. Is it scalable in terms of a long term? So I think those are the main things we are looking into, Ross, would you agree?
Yeah, and I also think it's things like, do they clearly articulate that in the pitch? And do they get it done in the time?
I mean, it's been so interesting to, you know, hear more about the competition, meet some of the finalists. It's a great thing to be involved in. So I'm sure the listeners will enjoy this episode. And we can't wait to come back in the new year and talk more about the Innovation Park and the opportunities in Norwich. So thanks both of you for your time today.
Thank you.
Great, thank you.
And before we go, let's speak to the winner.
So, John, congratulations. You are the winner of the 2024 Innovation Hothouse. How does that feel?
Amazing. Absolutely amazing. There were some really good presentations. I didn't expect to win it. It's a great achievement for the company. And it'll help us enormously.
And what kind of way do you think it will help you to start off with?
I think the great thing is it gives us more credibility that people, not just scientists, can see what we're doing and see the benefit of what we're doing. And we're doing it for the wider world, not just for a local or a regional or a national situation. We actually want to change the world.
Yeah, I think it's really impressive. You gave a great presentation. Very uniquely, you chose to do it with no slides and actually just talk to people. So what was your thinking process for doing that?
I guess because of what we're trying to achieve, I wanted people to actually listen to what I had to say. And rather than focus on a slide which had lots of words on and probably not hear what I was talking about, I wanted them to actually be engrossed in what was being said so they took away what's really happening and what we're trying to achieve.
Well, it's great news for you. Many congratulations, and I'll let you go off and start talking to a few more people now.
Thank you ever so much. Really appreciate it.
That was John Farley from iBoxit, and in second place was Knee3D, and in third place it was actually Rosario, who we just spoke to. You were in the audience, Faye. Were the winners who you expected?
Yeah, pretty much. So I got two out of three of them with iBoxit and PF Bio. I personally would have put Bioscopic in there too. I thought they were really interesting and they were first up and gave a great presentation. So that's always a challenge. Vita Vodka did really well. You know, obviously we spoke to them. They were very convincing and a really great chat. But the competition was high, so it just wasn't the day for them today, I'm afraid. But I don't think we've heard the last from them at all. And then I stayed and almost till the end. I made so many connections, I actually left the network in half an hour early. And you know, for me, that's quite an amazing feat. But I just knew, my poor brain was fried. And yeah, I want to be able to follow up with people. So, you know, really, really great day.
Today's show was produced by Carl Homer of Cambridge TV and supported by our media partner, Business Weekly. The Cambridge Tech Podcast is available on all major podcast platforms and on cambridgetechpodcast.com. If you've enjoyed this podcast, please give it a 5-star review. It'll really help others discover the show.
If you are a startup looking to grow in Cambridge, the Bradfield Centre offers a range of flexible membership packages which put you in control of your office and home working mix. There's a vibrant, collaborative atmosphere, on-site cafe, plenty of green outside space, and regular member social events. For more information, visit bradfieldcentre.com or call 01223 919 600.